This is an extract from the book The Age of Responsibility, CSR 2.0 and the New DNA of Business by Wayne Visser, read by the author. Chapter 13, Making a Difference. Cultivating Radicals. Have you ever done something radical and felt really good about it? Radicals are the root of all progress. Yet in a world of convention, being unconventional takes courage. All our lives we are taught compliance. We learn to obey. We are careful not to rock the boat. And we lose our natural appetite for questioning, that childish insistence to know why. We are schooled in the ways of groupthink, discouraged from challenging the status quo. And those who dare to question the ingrained assumptions, to challenge the established order, to reject popular opinion, are labelled radicals, outcasts, troublemakers, fringe lunatics. Yet what does it mean to be radical? It means to get to the root of things, to tap a deeper source, to go below the surface of shallow consensus. Radicals are feared because they threaten those in power who rely on the unquestioning acquiescence of the masses. Radicals are persecuted because they are the harbingers of change in a society that clings to stability. Yet radicals are the driving force behind human evolution. All the icons that history has judged to be great were radicals in their time. The Chinese philosopher Lao Tzu was radical when he proposed the way of flow in an era of rigid military imperialism. Gautama the Buddha was radical when he rejected his noble birth and founded the path of simple living. Moses was radical when he led the Israelites from slavery to freedom. Jesus was radical when he challenged the encrusted traditions of his own Jewish upbringing. Other great reformers throughout the ages were similarly regarded as heretics by their peers. Newton for replacing the Catholic cosmology with scientific theories, and Einstein for dismantling Newton's clockwork universe, Da Vinci for imagining how people might fly, and the Wright brothers for turning his prophecy into reality, Darwin for confronting creationists with the evidence of evolution, and Rupert Sheldrake for suggesting that the laws of nature are more like habits of morphic resonance, Gandhi for taking on the colonial might of Britain, and Mandela for fighting the scourge of apartheid. We greatly admire these giants of human civilization now, so what made them heretics in their day? The etymological root of the word heretic means able to choose. Perhaps this gives us a clue as to why they were reviled then and are lauded now. Heretics are messengers of freedom. And freedom is an anathema to the theocrats, bureaucrats, and plutocrats alike. People who think for themselves are more likely to question the scripted beliefs of religious dogma. They are less likely to blindly follow the dictates of authority, and they are more difficult to control and manipulate with money. Radicals are able to endure the ridicule of society because they have the power of conviction. Their ideas are rooted firmly in values, making their stand virtually unshakable. But radicals never exist in isolation. If they stand out above a crowd, it is only because they are raised on the shoulders of a dedicated band of committed supporters. Radicals are always part of a wider groundswell of change, riding on the bow of a wave of reform. Radicals are not agitators for the sake of contrariety. They shout in the deserts of the mainstream because they have a vision of a better way, a more honest way, a way which improves the lot of humankind. Radicals are the voice of the oppressed who cannot speak and of the poor to whom no one listens. Radicals are the hands of the innovators whose minds are tied to contracts and the entrepreneurs whose souls are bought by commerce. We are all radicals just waiting for our moment of destiny, straining for our call to a higher purpose, wishing for the courage to do the right thing. The root of our actions, and indeed the root to action, lies within. As we reach deep down into the soil of our being, we tap into our radical core of inspiration. So why not do something radical yourself today, just for a change? Are we happy? In the face of unprecedented global challenges like financial market instability, persistent poverty, and climate change, can we as individuals, radical or otherwise, really make a difference? And if we can, what motivates us to devote our time and energies to addressing social, environmental, and ethical issues? Based on research for my PhD, which is written up in detail in my book, Making a Difference, I believe that corporate sustainability and responsibility provide a powerful way to address the existential gap or lack of deeper self-sense of purpose and meaning and job satisfaction felt by many people in business today. A survey a few years ago by London PR firm called Fish Can Sing hinted at the extent of the problem. It found that 66% of all 18 to 35-year-olds were unhappy at work. The proportion rose to 83% among 30 to 35-year-olds. 1 in 15 respondents had already quit the rat race, and 45% were seriously contemplating a career change. This last group was described as being made up of tireds, or 30-something independent, radical, educated dropouts. These otherwise highly successful and motivated professionals were found to be lacking something in their working lives. They wanted less work-related stress, shorter working hours, more job satisfaction, and higher quality of life. In other words, less demand and greater reward. What's more, the existential crisis does not appear to be confined either to the 30-something age group or to the UK. According to the World Watch Institute, today the same number of Americans, about a third, report being very happy, as they did in 1957, even though they are as a group twice as wealthy as they were 50 years ago. The New Economics Foundation's Happy Planet Index, which measures the relative efficiency with which nations convert the planet's natural resources into long and happy lives for their citizens, is also revealing. High scores are only achievable by meeting all three targets embodied in the index: high life expectancy, high life satisfaction, and a low ecological footprint. The highest Happy Planet Index score is for Costa Rica. Of the following 10 countries, all but one is Latin American. The highest ranking group of the G20 in terms of the Happy Planet Index is Brazil, in 9th place out of 143. Together, Latin American and Caribbean nations have the highest mean Happy Planet Index score for any region. Rich developed nations fall somewhere in the middle. The highest placed Western nation is the Netherlands, 43rd out of 143. The UK ranks midway down the table, 74th, behind Germany, Italy and France. It is just beaten by Georgia and Slovakia, but beats Japan and Ireland. The USA comes a long way back, in 114th place. So what is going on here? Viktor Frankl, author of Man's Search for Meaning, and a personal survivor of 4 Nazi concentration camps, suggests that the Western pursuit of economic growth may be to blame. Consider today's society, he says. It gratifies and satisfies virtually every need except for one, the need for meaning. This spreading meaning vacuum is especially evident in affluent industrial countries. People have the means for living, but not the meanings. Management thinker Charles Handy puts it another way. He says, "We seem to be saying that life is about economics, that money is the measure of things. My hunch is that most of us don't believe any of this and that it won't work. But we are trapped in our own rhetoric and have as yet nothing else to offer, not even a different way to talk about it." Handy may be right. Then again, surely one different way to talk about it is through the language of sustainability and responsibility. After all, these are matters which run deep. They are matters of values and beliefs, of higher aspirations and noble causes. And yet even here, we find the prevailing rhetoric of CSR is mostly about the business case. talk of the moral case or the personal case for CSR is taboo, as if stripping human emotion and personal motivation from the debate on how companies should behave somehow makes it more credible, more effective. My research suggests that this corporatized, depersonalized approach to CSR is failing to tap the massive source of energy for constructive change that exists in companies and the world. The reason is that the CSR zombie view of the world, reflected in the mantra, "I only do corporate sustainability and responsibility because it's good for business," this completely fails to appreciate why people choose to work in CSR, what satisfaction they derive from this work, and what motivates them to keep trying to make a positive difference despite huge obstacles and frustrations. The simple fact of the matter is that CSR students, professionals, and enthusiasts are all change agents. We are the champions. What do we know about the role of individuals as change agents? Intuitively, we resonate with adages such as Gandhi's "Be the change you want to see in the world," or Margaret Mead's famous quote, "Never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens can change the world. Indeed, it's the only thing that ever does." But beyond these clichés, what do we really know about change in the context of CSR? The first rich vein of research to mine is the concept of champions within organizations. This goes back to the emergence of human resource champions in the 1980s. In the 1990s, firms started to apply the idea to environmental management and corporate social performance as well. Hence, a CSR champion became someone who has the ability to translate a set of personal beliefs about creating a just and sustainable future into an attractive vision for their organization or sector. Or put another way, they are masters at identifying, packaging, and selling social and environmental issues to those that have the power and influence to address them. CSR champions do not always have formal corporate sustainability and responsibility roles. They are often described as being action-oriented, enthusiasts, inspirers, experts, volunteers, communicators, networkers, sponsors, implementers, and catalysts. They demonstrate that, contrary to popular belief, individuals have considerable discretion within organizations to pursue and promote agendas that they are passionate about. Crucially, however, they need a combination of knowledge and skills to be successful. For example, they need to be able to gather sufficient credible information to make a rational case for change. They need the ability to tell an emotionally compelling story about a more sustainable future. And they need enough political savvy and interpersonal skills to persuade others, especially leaders, to listen and take action. CSR professionals are effective change agents, therefore, when they act as champions. One safety, health, and environmental manager I spoke to talked about his role in convincing his organization, which was a large chemical company, to phase out the use of various harmful substances, such as CFCs, PCBs, and asbestos. He said to me it was a major achievement to convince the 30,000 colleagues of mine in the company to move out of this business before legislation hit us. This still doesn't tell us what motivates us to engage with the agenda in the first place. Talking to CSR professionals, by which I mean managers, consultants, academics, and NGO representatives working on corporate social, environmental, and ethical issues, the desire to create change recurs as a consistent theme, but the way in which they make change happen and the satisfaction they derive as a result differs considerably. For some, as one might have guessed, values play an important role. In particular, CSR is seen as a way to align work with personal values. For example, one manager I interviewed said, "It's the inner drive. It's the way I'm put together. My value system. My belief system. It's my Christian belief. My ethical approach." Another explained that it is important to have inspirational leadership and people who align with your value sets. For many CSR professionals, their motivation also derives from the fact that sustainability and responsibility are such dynamic, complex, and challenging concepts. The satisfaction is huge, said one corporate responsibility manager, because there is no day that is the same when you get into your office. It's always changing. It's always different. Another reflected that CSR painted a much bigger picture and is just as holistic as you want it to be. It requires a far broader vision. Types of CSR change agents. These two factors, values alignment and the CSR concept, were fairly cross-cutting motivators that I identified in my research. However, it is also possible to identify four fairly distinctive types of CSR professional based on how they derive satisfaction from their work. In practice, every individual draws on all four types, but the center of gravity rests with one, representing the mode of operating in which that individual feels most comfortable, fulfilled, or satisfied. The first type of CSR change agent is the expert. Experts find their motivation through engaging with projects or systems, giving expert input, focusing on technical excellence, seeking uniqueness through specialization, and pride in problem-solving abilities. To illustrate, one expert-type CSR professional said, "There were a couple of projects that I did that I found very exciting. It was very exciting to get all the bits and pieces in place, then commission them and see them starting to work." Another expert said, "I usually get that sense of meaning in work when I've finished a product, say like an environmental report, and you see, you know, I've put in a lot of effort here, and now you have the results. Or you do a series of community consultations and you get the feedback." The second type of CSR change agent is the facilitator. Common themes among facilitators are deriving motivation from transferring knowledge and skills, focusing on people development, creating opportunities for staff, changing the attitudes or perceptions of individuals, and paying attention to team building. For example, one facilitator-type CSR professional said, "If you enjoy working with people, this is a sort of functional role where you have direct interaction. You can see people being empowered, having increased knowledge, and you can see what that eventually leads to." Another facilitator explained that, "The part of my work that I've enjoyed most is training, where I get the opportunity to work with a group of people, to interact with people at a very personal level. You can see how things start to get clear for them in terms of understanding issues and how that applies to what they do." The third type of CSR change agent is the catalyst. For catalysts, motivation is associated with initiating change, giving strategic direction, influencing leadership, tracking organizational performance, and having a big picture perspective. One catalyst type CSR professional claimed, "The type of work that I'm doing is giving direction in terms of where the company is going. So it can almost become a life purpose to steer the company in a direction that you believe is personally right as well." Another said, "I like getting things changed. My time is spent trying to influence people. The really interesting thing is trying to get managing directors, plant managers, business leaders, and sales guys to think differently and to change what they do." That is quite different from the fourth type of CSR change agent, the activist. For activists, motivation comes from being aware of broader social and environmental issues, feeling part of the community, making a contribution to poverty eradication, fighting for a just cause, and leaving a legacy of improved conditions in society. One activist type CSR professional said, "It's also about the issue of being poor. It actually touches you. You see these people living in appalling conditions, the shacks, the drinking water is so dirty, and there's no running water at all. You see those kinds of things and it hits you and you think, what can you do?" Another confessed, "I think my purpose here is to help others in some way and leave a legacy for my kids to follow. I could leave a legacy behind where I actually set up a school, a kids' school, or a campus for disadvantaged people, taking street kids out and doing something, building homes for single parents." Dynamics of CSR change agents. The different types of CSR change agents find some resonance in the broader management literature. The catalyst type clearly draws on a strategic role and applies it to sustainability and responsibility, bringing in a lot of ideas from change management. Arguably, the facilitator finds echoes in the servant leadership concept, while activists are probably best described in the work on social and environmental entrepreneurship. There are also glimpses of the expert in much of the more technical scholarship on environmental and quality management. It is important to note, however, that the CSR change agent's typology is dynamic. In the same way that sources of meaning in life can vary over the life cycle or other changing circumstances, there is ample evidence to suggest that CSR professionals' default types can change as well. One CSR manager I interviewed seemed to have shifted from being an activist to a facilitator, moving from political campaigning when he was a business ethics lecturer to business training and lecturing in a large consultancy. Another had moved from expert to catalyst, doing laboratory work on ecotoxicity, then strategic policy advice in a safety, health and environmental center. And yet another had moved from expert to facilitator, a technical environmental manager for a chemical company who became the head of a team of sustainability consultants. For some, but not all, CSR change agents, their formal job roles and their type are aligned, as in the examples cited above. Hence, there is a suggestion that either people are naturally attracted to roles that fit with their change agent types, or that their roles shape the meaning they derive, or perhaps both. One manager explained that, in your career or in your work, the manager must be able to swing from one type to the other. Another important influence is organizational context. For instance, one CSR professional observed that the organizational dynamics of corporates require conformism to the organizational culture, which to a large degree requires maintenance of the status quo. This makes it difficult for activists. Career stage or life cycle is another important factor. One of the things that you have to bear in mind, said one of the managers, is how much individual flexibility you get in working environments. I think at an earlier stage in someone's career, no matter what their typology might be, they don't necessarily yet have the luxury of finding themselves in the position that gives expression to their preference. Making a difference. Beyond simply improving our understanding of CSR change agents, there are several practical uses for the typology. The most obvious applications occur at an individual and team level, where benefits for CSR managers, managers of CSR teams, and human resource managers exist. For CSR managers, the typology acts as a prompt for individuals to reflect on their most natural type or mix of types. This allows them to think about what sort of roles they derive the most satisfaction from, and to consciously compare this to their formal role. If there is not a natural fit between their type and their formal role, it may help to explain work frustrations or lack of motivation. For managers of a CSR team, the typology helps to cast light on the mix of team members from the perspective of their different sources of motivation. This can influence the way in which individuals are managed and allocated tasks, as well as the general management style adopted. For example, for a team full of experts, incentives that recognize quality may be far more effective than for a catalyst-heavy team, where tracking of strategic goals may be more motivational. The manager of a CSR team may decide that there is merit in having a balance of all four types represented, which will in turn affect recruitment decisions. One of the underlying messages of my CSR change agency research is that companies stand to gain a lot by going beyond the business case for CSR. In other words, by justifying sustainability and responsibility efforts on the basis of values, or what some call the moral case. Taking this position, in addition to rather than instead of the business case, will enable companies to tap into a powerful source of motivation, namely the satisfaction that CSR managers, and in all likelihood many other employees, derive from the alignment of work with values. Ultimately, the typology is a recognition that all of us working in CSR are motivated and satisfied by different things. At the same time, we are all trying to make a difference. And being able to make a difference through our work is an immense privilege. As one of the CSR people I interviewed put it, I think people that are working in the area of sustainable development have a great sense of purpose, in the sense of assisting people and making a difference, leaving a legacy and having strong values. To give a more practical example, someone working in the pharmaceutical industry told me about a massive program where they were distributing 6 billion tablets to wipe out lymphatic fibrosis. This is a type of elephantiasis disease in Africa. Definitely you feel like, wow, we're making a difference, he said. We're not just pumping out toothpaste. Another, working in professional services, said, there's making a difference in terms of what you suggest a company does, but then there's the personal making a difference, which is very different. That's about putting your money where your mouth is, where you're personally committing your time, your own effort. And of course, most of the time, we are not contemplating our navel. We're out there fighting the good fight. One of my colleagues said, there's so much to do. I haven't got time to think about the meaning of life. The alarm clock goes off and I'm out. Just go, just go. I get home and I think, what the hell have I done today? But I've been incredibly busy, phoning, talking, making presentations. It's just when you stand back that you see that perhaps you are making a difference. But most of the time, you just do it. To scare or to inspire. So how do we just do it? What is the most effective strategy? And in particular, how do you get the balance between sharing the bad news, in other words, the state of the world, and the good news, the innovative solutions? Betty Sue Flowers, co-author of Presence, told me that if you attempt to scare people with the enormity of the problems, the tendency is simply to give up. When you dispirit people, when you remove the spirit, you also remove the capacity to change. This is a common refrain and indeed a dilemma. We can't deny the severity of the crises that we face, and yet we can't paralyze people with fear. I'm impaled on this every day of my life at the moment, Jonathan Porritt told me. What do you think? I think we still owe it to reality and to integrity in any communications process to share the empirical reality. But how do you come out of that without leaving people spread-eagled with despair and just utterly disempowered? Porritt went on to say, we're trying to create these upbeat, opportunity-driven wish lists about what would happen if business seized hold of this set of opportunities here and started to do things completely differently over there, and if politicians started to construct societal and economic responses based on a world not on growth hormones. But then you look at the scale of their responses and you set it against the scale of the analysis, and of course it looks frail. It looks insubstantial in terms of where we need to be. So I think the mechanisms we're using are the only ones available to us, but we haven't got it right yet. Whether we can get there, building, gradually over a period of time, or whether we need some shocks in the system to accelerate the emergence of that positive energy, that for me is still a hard one to call. Jorgen Randers, co-author of Limits to Growth, is equally ambivalent. He says, are scare tactics better than carrots? There are groups pursuing both avenues. I think I've moved to thinking that having a positive view has a stronger motivational force than scare tactics. But then you can ask the question, is it possible to come up with sufficient carrots to make society act? And it looks as if support from some scare tactics or some of the disasters would help. The 21st Century Living Project, undertaken by Okona in conjunction with Homebase and the Eden Project, may provide some answers. Based on an 18-month study of 100 households in the UK, the findings show that most people will act, given the right tools and information specifically for their needs. They explain that the data say clearly that environmental values are not a good predictor of action. The message we got back, they said, was clear. we can get on with cutting our environmental footprint without having to win the battle for the long-term soul of the nation. Don't browbeat people, don't frighten them, just show them where they are wasting money and resources, and they will change themselves. Frame the topic like this, and everyone is interested, young and old, wealthy and poor, green or not. Like all of us in the CSR field, I've also been grappling with the issue of whether it is best to scare or inspire. In my case, however, this was also critical in a post-apartheid South Africa. The country was in the grip of pessimism after the euphoria of its political miracle had evaporated and the massive challenges of social upliftment became clear. This was the subject of my book called South Africa Reasons to Believe, in which my co-author Guy Lundy and I conclude that there are two basic ingredients to being positive. The first is to recognize that our pessimistic views are generally skewed by unbalanced media reporting. We have to remember that our mental state is determined by what we focus on. It's not the media that is lying, it's just that they are painting a picture of the world that is highly selective. They are like manic depressive artists patching together a collage, using bits and pieces of real events, most of which happen to be dark or disturbing. So we need to start exposing ourselves to more of the positive news stories in order to get a more balanced perspective of what is going on around us. The second ingredient to being positive is to recognize that our attitude influences the world around us, for better or worse. The neutral scientist in the white coat is a myth. He or she does not exist. The observer and the observed are not separate. They are always inextricably linked. Everything we believe or think or value changes the world around us. It even affects our physical health. Attitudes are like lenses that color what we see, but they are also like yeast in bread. They have a very real, visible effect on the outcome of whatever we are trying to make work, whether it is a family, a business, a nation, or even a whole planet. This is not just a philosophical point. Optimism comes from actively engaging with life's challenges. Reasons to be optimistic. Stuart Hart, author of Capitalism at the Crossroads, shares his attitude of optimism, and especially on the role of business, when he says, "I'm a pragmatist, in the sense that I look around and try to assess where the leverage points are for change to occur most rapidly. I don't see government and I don't see civil society being able to lead that process per se, or to act on their own to make it happen. And so it leaves the world of commerce really as the most logical and maybe the only institution left to look at. And there I see both the potential for great harm, and obviously that's the path we've been on, we're headed rapidly for the cliff, but also for great potential to change quickly. What makes the world of commerce interesting in my mind is its ability to creatively destroy itself. When the conditions are right, capitalist institutions, including companies and the competitive process, can generate change in a hurry, and that's what we desperately need. So I think if we're able to turn this ship to really reframe what capitalism might look like in the 21st century, then we have a mechanism through which this change could unfold at the rate that it needs to, in order to move us towards a sustainable world before it's too late." Likewise, Jeffrey Sachs, author of The End of Poverty, is optimistic. "Every time I turn around," he told me, "whether it's in India, whether it's in China and Malaysia, Tanzania, there's no shortage of reasons for optimism. In fact, the power of our technologies, the wonders of our information linkages, now creates a world where isolation, which was the essence of poverty, has been broken, where a cell phone is within reach of just about any village, thereby making a link for people who were desperately outside of the chain of information and are now part of markets and global knowledge. There's all the reasons for optimism." For William McDonough, being a designer requires that he is an optimist, because the nature of design, he says, is to make the world better. He explained this perspective to me, saying, "When I see the energy in people directed to help solve these problems, and the resources and funding that are being directed towards these questions, I think it's quite a different moment. I don't think of it as a bubble, I think of it as a boom. There are harbingers of hope all over the landscape. It may be too late for a lot of the things around toxification and climate change and things like that, but if we let that stop us from our creative intention, then we stop designing. And the day we stop designing, we lose all hope. Amory Lovins, in his typically quirky and insightful way, told me that he is not on the optimist-pessimist axis at all. "I don't view the glass as half empty or half full," he said. "I think a glass has 100% design margin expandable by efficiency." My old mentor David Brower, he reflected, taught that optimism and pessimism are different faces of the same simplistic and irresponsible surrender to fatalism, treating the future as fate, not a choice, and not taking responsibility for creating a future we want. To hope is human. So what does give us hope? For Amory Lovins, three things stand out. First, the rapid rise of awareness and leadership in the private sector, and the corresponding awakening of civil society, empowered by the emerging global central nervous system. Second, the fact that brains are evenly distributed, one per person. And as he put it, as far as we know, there's nothing in the universe so powerful as 6 billion minds wrapping around a problem. And third, the quality of the new generation of young people, who realize there is less time and they need to get on with it. Elizabeth Economy, author of The River Runs Black, said to me that she takes all her inspiration and hope for the future of China from China's environmental activists and from the Chinese people themselves. They're pioneers, and every day, every one of them is challenged by a system that in many ways is antithetical to strong and good environmental protection. And they're pushing it in terms of those issues of transparency and the rule of law and accountability, and putting their lives on the line in some cases, she said to me. Simon Zadek, author of The Civil Corporation, told me that his hope doesn't arise from a sense that amazing things are about to happen, that human nature is about to change, that global consciousness is about to be formed, that a revolution is about to take place, that technology will solve the problem, or even in a sort of Margaret Mead way, that there's always some fantastic person down the road doing something amazing. "My hope," he said, "comes from my very direct experience of trying to make change. I think it's through the habit every day of trying to make change that one maintains an ambition about the possibility." Vandana Shiva agrees. Hope, she said to me, comes through engaging in positive action with communities and people. Every seed we save, every new farmer who goes organic, every time a new food product is bought by a local community, a good, nutritious, healthy, ecological product, every one of those things, and that happens daily, she said. Hunter Lovins, on the other hand, puts her hope in distributed leadership. She told me, "I rather like the line from Lord of the Rings on leadership, where Gandalf says, 'The rule of no realm is mine. That all worthy things that are in peril as the world now stands, those are my care. And for my part, I shall not wholly fail if anything passes through this night that can still grow fair and bear fruit and flower again in the days to come. For I too am a steward, did you not know?'" Her conclusion is that it doesn't matter if you're a wizard or a king or the CEO of Walmart, because remember, in the end, it was the little people. It was the two fun-loving, unassuming hobbits who had to take on their shoulders that awesome task. And they were scared and they didn't know where they were going, but in the end, all the kings and warriors and wizards could just stand by as the little people saved the world. I think real leadership is extraordinary courage by ordinary people. Experiments in generosity. When I think of what gives me hope, it is the extraordinary people I meet and come across in my work on corporate sustainability and responsibility, especially those conducting experiments in generosity. For example, Derek Sivers, whom I only became aware of while writing this book. I will let him tell his own story. He says, "When I decided to sell my company, CDBaby, in 2008, I already had enough. I live simply. I hate waste and excess. I have a good apartment, a good laptop, and a few other basics. But the less I own, the happier I am. The lack of possessions gives me the priceless freedom to live anywhere, anytime. Having too much money can be harmful. It throws off perspective. It makes people do stupid things like buy extra cars or houses they don't use, or upgrade to first class for only $10,000 so that they can be a little more comfortable for a few hours. So I didn't need or even want the money from the sale of the company. I just wanted to make sure I had enough for a simple, comfortable life. The rest should go to music education, since that's what made such a difference in my life. So I found a great way to do this. I created a charitable trust called the Independent Musicians Charitable Remainder Uni Trust. When I die, all of its assets will go to music education. But while I'm alive, it pays out 5% of its value per year to me. 5% is still the minimum allowed by law. It's too much. I would have preferred 1%, but oh well, I'm free to use it to start new businesses, to help people, or whatever. A few months before the sale, I transferred the ownership of CDBaby and HostBaby, all the intellectual property like trademarks and software, into the trust. It was irreversibly and irrevocably gone. It was no longer mine. It all belonged to the charitable trust. Then, when disc makers bought it, they bought it not from me but from the trust, turning it into a $22 million cash to benefit music education. So instead of me selling the company and getting taxed on the income and giving what's left to charity, that move of giving away the company to charity, then having the charity sell it, saved about $5 million in taxes. Amazing story. Another experiment in generosity that I encountered over the past year, while I was on my CSR Quest World Tour, was lentil as anything. I had the good fortune to spend some time with Shanaka Fernando, the founder entrepreneur of this Melbourne-based restaurant chain. Fernando is one of those rare pioneers who are prepared to live by their convictions, to flout social convention and challenge the status quo. After a failed stint as a Buddhist monk in his home country of Sri Lanka, he fell in love with a nun, had a torrid affair and got kicked out. He came to Australia and dabbled in law studies. It wasn't fulfilling, so he gave it up to travel on a shoestring around the third world for 6 years, learning about culture and community along the way. When he returned to Australia, Fernando started a business importing saris made from recycled fabrics, which made him enough money to start his current social experiment called Lentil as Anything. I call it a social experiment because the business goes beyond simply being a social enterprise. Like other social businesses, Lentil as Anything embraces the entrepreneurial spirit while it seeks to have a significant positive influence on the development of the community. But there is something more unique, more challenging, more sublime and more subversive because it gets to the heart of human nature and the essence of Western capitalism. I'm talking about generosity and money. Through Lentil as Anything, Fernando is trying to foster a culture of generosity. What would happen, he wondered, if there were no prices? What if people only paid what they could afford or what they thought the food was worth? Or what if they were inspired to pay a certain amount? Is there enough generosity left in Western society to run a viable business on the principle of giving and sharing rather than profit maximization? Would the free rider problem kick in with people taking advantage of the free food? According to Fernando, all kinds of interesting things happen when people are faced with the magic box, that little wooden chest that people can place their donations in as they leave. A few, very, very few, take advantage. Some who genuinely can't afford to pay offer to chop vegetables or do dishes. Others make their own assessment of what is a fair price to pay. Some are quietly generous, while others make a theatrical gesture of placing their donation in the magic box. But it all goes beyond the money. Other unexpected things happen too. As I looked around the restaurant, I noticed that this is not a people like me experience, where you are surrounded by those from your own socioeconomic or ethno-cultural strata. Lentil as Anything has succeeded in mixing it up, cutting across traditional divides. And because of the philosophy of the place, you may find a wealthy businessman striking up a conversation with a subsistence artist. When you create these kinds of creative connections, it is a potent recipe for innovation, for rediscovering what it means to be human. Fernando insists that Lentil as Anything is first and foremost about good food. Interestingly, vegetarian food, because that is the most inclusive, making concerns about halal or kosher or meat-based preparation less tricky. But it is clearly more than that. It is an invitation to restore our faith in the essential goodness of humanity and the wholesome nature of community. And what, you may ask, has all this to do with CSR? Well, I believe it is pioneers like Fernando and the others discussed in this book that are at the forefront of the CSR 2.0 wave. If we subject Lentil as Anything to the five tests of CSR 2.0, it scores well. Is Lentil creative? Yes. Is it scalable? Not sure. Is it responsive? Extremely. Is it global? Yes, it thinks globally but acts locally. Is it circular? Mostly, yes. Local production and recycling are part of the philosophy and practice. Even in terms of scalability, Lentil as Anything gives me pause to think about what I mean by that. If we accept Chris Anderson's long tail approach to scalability, the restaurant doesn't have to go from 4 to 40,000 branches to be scalable. It could be that 10,000 independent restaurants, all inspired by a similar philosophy, pop up all around the world and turn the generosity experiment into a global movement. As the world recovers from the age of greed that culminated in the global financial crisis, it is refreshing to be reminded of the rightful place of money in society. Money is always a means to an end, never the end in itself. Melbourne, and indeed the world, would be a poorer place if brave experiments like Lentil as Anything were allowed to fail. Let us make sure that, in the battle of generosity versus money, generosity wins hands down. Answering the question, why? That seems like a good note to end on, but I want to finish by telling one more story. It is a true story with a message, told by Polish journalist Ryszard Kapuscinski in his remarkable book, The Shadow of the Sun. He was travelling to Onitsha, a small town in eastern Nigeria, which is legendary for having the biggest market in Africa, perhaps in the world. A few kilometers outside of town, he got stuck in a monumental traffic jam. After an hour of not moving, Kapuscinski got out and walked into town in an attempt to discover the source of the problem. I will let him tell the rest of the story. In one spot, the street was crowded. There was a noisy, nervous commotion. Engines were roaring. You could hear shouting and calling. Once I pushed myself through the throng, I saw an enormous gaping hole in the middle of the street, huge, wide, several meters deep. It had steep, sheer sides, and its bottom was an opaque, muddy pond. The street was so narrow here that you couldn't go around the hole, and everyone who wanted to drive into town had to descend first into this abyss, plunge into its swampy waters, and then hope that someone, somehow, would pull them out. I was immediately struck by how the area around the hole had become the epicenter of local life, how it drew people, engaged them, spurred them to initiative and action. In the normal, sleepy, lifeless backwater on the outskirts of town, where the unemployed slumber in the streets and packs of dogs roam, there arose, suddenly and spontaneously, thanks solely to that unfortunate hole, a dynamic, humming, bustling neighbourhood. The hole created work for the unemployed, who formed teams of rescuers and made money hauling cars out of the pit. It brought new customers for the women operating sidewalk eateries. Because of the attendant traffic jam, shoppers appeared in previously empty local shops, serving the passengers and drivers of cars waiting to get through. Hawkers of cigarettes and cold drinks found buyers for their wares. The curse of drivers travelling to Onitsha became the salvation of the residents of the road and of this entire neighbourhood. It was further proof that every evil thing has its defenders, because everywhere there are those whom evil sustains, for whom it is an opportunity, life itself. For a long time, people did not allow this hole to be repaired. I know this because when years later I was telling someone in Lagos with great emotion about my adventure in Onitsha, he replied with an absolutely indifferent tone of voice, "Onitsha, it's always like that in Onitsha." The moral of the story is that today, as a global society, we are facing that crater in the road. Our social, environmental, and ethical crises. It doesn't help to point fingers at who created the hole. It is the result of our collective actions, the erosion caused by the relentless drive of consumptive, inequitable capitalism. The sad fact of the matter is that many people still benefit from our gigantic pothole of unsustainability and irresponsibility. Businesses, politicians, even NGOs. What's more, many of us working in CSR are like the street vendors. We help to make the inconvenience of the crisis a little more comfortable for the drivers. We sustain the rescue teams and we converse with the curious onlookers. But we're still not repairing the hole. Of course, we all know, including the truck drivers of the global capitalist economy, that the situation is ultimately unsustainable and irresponsible. But we need the courage to challenge the status quo, to stand up to those who are entrenched in the system, to question the integrity and wisdom of the beneficiaries of inertia. The age of responsibility will only dawn when those of us working in corporate sustainability and responsibility, whether as leaders of business, regulators, managers, consultants, activists, teachers, or students, only when we focus our efforts not on those hauling the trucks out of the hole, but rather on filling in the hole. We are on the brink of the post-industrial revolution, and we need to decide whether we will be accomplices in slowing that transition or catalysts in speeding us towards a better future. As Manfred Max Neef, author of Economics Unmasked, puts it, "Let us imagine that economics becomes again the manner of managing the household in order to achieve the art of living and living well, respecting the right of all others to achieve the same within the limits of the carrying capacity of our planet." There is a saying in Africa that there are two hungers, the lesser hunger and the greater hunger. The lesser hunger is for the things that sustain life, goods and services and the money to pay for them. The greater hunger is for an answer to the question, why? For some understanding of what life is for. CSR change agents have a fantastic opportunity to feed the greater hunger by making a constructive difference and leaving a positive legacy. As Viktor Frankl said, each person is questioned by life, and only they can answer to life by answering for their own life. This book has been an existential questioning for me. Is working in corporate sustainability and responsibility a good answer to my life's question? In the end, I'm convinced that it is, but only if we can unmask the limitations of CSR 1.0, the defensive, charitable, promotional, and strategic versions of CSR. Only if we can embrace CSR 2.0, systemic CSR, corporate sustainability and responsibility that judges its success and improvements in the overall cultural, social, economic, and ecological system. I hope you will join me on this quest and find your unique and invaluable way to make a difference through CSR. If you want to stay up to date with CSR 2.0 ideas, feel free to be in touch at wayne@waynevisser.com or keep in touch with the latest thinking and content on CSR 2.0 by keeping an eye on the ageofresponsibilityblogspot.com or www.csrinternational.org.